but let's start with the flat load error. I ignored the guidebooks. I couldn't ignore the 1-inch piece of what looked like obsidian that shanked the left rear 33-inch tire. I bolted on the spare. Since it was Saturday during elk hunting season, anyone who could hold a gun, which included anyone who owned a tire repair facility along the route, was out trying to bag winter meat. I made it to Tuck at about 6 p.m. on my 4 good tires. I didn't want to dally in Tuck until Monday, hoping someone there could patch a large hole. But I didn't want to try to cross the Dempster again without backup rubber, even if I was now ready to try slow, patient going. Grandma's kitchen turned out to be a trailer park behind a house at the end of a tiny road, the trailer sitting on a wide gravel beach between the house and the Arctic Sea. Grandma's kitchen was boarded up. Ugh. A sign said to come around to the patio on the back side of the house. That's where I met John Steen and spent a preposterous night. I learned about the people and the town. I ate whale. I wore the most amazing homemade Inuit coat filled with snow goose down and lined with wolverine fur. I held forth with various citizens over kokanee beer until 3 a.m., and I slept in John's man cave. The Jeep tire was too big for John's repair rig, but John asked a friend, one who'd arrived at the party in a t-shirt, shorts, and flip-flops in 10-degree weather, if his friend's larger rig could handle it. The friend said yes and that he'd have the tire fixed for me the next morning. That honorable man had the BFG all-terrain patch tied on Sunday and showed me the offending geology. With 5 good tires, I made it back through the tundra, and eventually home. Ever since, I've occasionally received comic and cryptic messages from John. Last October, an early evening spate of messages turned into a phone call. Johnny, he said, you should come up here and we can hop on the snowmobiles and I'll take you jiggling. When should I come? May is the best time. I'll be there. I had no idea what jiggling was, and I told him not to tell me. When the Inuit invite you on a 10,000-mile round trip to do something called jiggling, you say yes and prepare. My prep included needing some kind of rig to make the journey to Tuck, which I'd now taken to calling Jiggle City. I own a 1994 Toyota Land Cruiser that would be perfect. Yet I wasn't satisfied with that option. I began looking for old vans, my search pulling up E-Series ambulances. If I could find a decent one for under $5,000, that would blow the jambulance is my Rufus, a DJ not far from me, DJ Kivi Kev, needed to get rid of his 1994 Ford F-350 ambulance. He had named it the Jambulance, and it was covered in lettering for his DJ services, including its name. It also listed the DJ's phone number, the last 4 numbers of which formed the word piss. To remember the number, I tell my clients, 772 I piss on you, he told me. They never forget. Under the hood, the Jambulance hides Ford's non-turbocharged 7.3-liter IDI indirect injection diesel V8. It would only start with a healthy hosing of starter fluid, but once it was running it sounded smooth. Kev told me the only thing the truck needed was the rear brakes bled. He wanted $2,000. This was a screaming steal. On January 5th, I gave Kev $2,000, called a tow truck, and sent my dog to the vet, being Beachmont Ford, for a full diagnosis. I had a little more than 3 months to get everything ready for the haul. It only took 2 days to find out my Rufus, my Jambulance, needed a lot more than its brakes bled.